So, wow. Thank you everybody for coming. Thank you, Adam, for the introduction. Sorry? No, it's okay. I don't know. Can anybody hear me? Is it too loud? A bit louder, please. Hello, hello? Is it better now? Okay. So, thank you everybody very much for coming. So many people, I'm quite shocked. There's so much interest in AI and potentially what we do at GoodAI here in Brno. So thanks for coming. My name is Jan Feyereisl, and right now I'm working at GoodAI as a senior research scientist and as an executive director of our newly funded AI Roadmap Institute. And I would like to talk about a number of things today. First, I'll talk a little bit about GoodAI. So actually, who heard about GoodAI? Please put your hand up. Okay, so most people. So I'll talk a little bit about GoodAI, what we do, what we are trying to achieve, and about some of our initiatives. So the general AI challenge that we released about a month ago, and this new institute. And then I'll talk a little bit more about some technical aspects or technical ideas that I believe are really interesting and people should focus on more, because I think the community is too focused on doing specific things within a certain small region of interest, but to actually go beyond what we have now, we need to look much more wider at different fields, different areas. So for those of you who don't know about GoodAI, it was founded in 2004 by our CEO Marek Rosa. Actually, he founded a company called Keen Software House, which is a games development company. And we have developed two games, Space Engineers and Medieval Engineers. Any of you actually played any of those games? Okay, four people, five people. Actually, both of those games are fairly successful. And this is what enabled Marek to invest $10 million of his own money to actually start up GoodAI. And it was to treat a lifelong dream of actually building general AI. So GoodAI is all about building generally intelligent machines. And actually our motto is build general artificial intelligence as fast as possible to help humanity and understand the universe. And the important thing here is as fast as possible, because we have a number of initiatives and we try to do things in such a way that will actually speed up the way that we get to much more general intelligent machines. And we actually take it quite seriously because we set ourselves a deadline of 10 years, and by the entrance to our offices we have a countdown clock that counts every single minute and second to that deadline. So, and every meeting we actually have a reminder from Marek how much time we have left. So we are about 20 international researchers. We are located in Prague, in Karlín, in those beautiful offices. And we have a number of teams that focus on different things. Some of them focus on building architectures. Some of them focus on building something that we called a school, which is essentially an environment which is specially tailored for building intelligent agents. And we have a number of software engineers who help us actually code up a lot of this stuff. And in addition, we have two other companies. One of them is GoodAI Applied, which is essentially getting the knowledge, the know-how, the R&D expertise, and applying it in business. And Keen VR, which is more related to the games, which is where you can actually go and play with virtual reality. Some of you who actually heard about GoodAI, you might have heard about Brain Simulator. So this was one of the software tools that we developed a number of years ago, which was much more machine learning specific, focused on actually putting together more standard components, building architectures, and letting them learn from data. But more recently, we have released this new simulator, which is much more focused on the type of things that we are interested in doing now, which is much more dynamic, growing, distributed type of architectures that can be computed on a huge number of computers. So if you're interested, you can go on our websites and actually check those tools out. They're all open source and available. And this is an example of another thing that we released, which is this School for AI. which is our environment, and you can essentially see that it's an environment where you can define different sets of tasks, where actually you can choose what task you want. You can create a curriculum which is specifically tailored for the agent so that he's guided in the way that he's taught. And you can see some environments which are essentially the tasks that are being presented to the agent, and the agent needs to solve something in them. And it's important to know that there are actually a number of things. It's all about gradual learning. So how can you build an agent that gradually acquires knowledge according to some curriculum that is of increasing complexity and that is somehow guided by the teacher and continuously learns forever? So we have a number of teams that work on different architectures, and I'll quickly give you an overview of some of them. So we have one team who is looking at something they called OMAN, which is essentially a memory augmented neural network. So I don't know how many of you know those kind of approaches, but essentially they want to explore how to create systems that have not only neural networks or deep neural networks as their base, but that also exploit some external memory. And they do this for program induction. So they're trying to essentially compose a set of pre-hard-coded functions and learn them in a sequence to solve things like addition, sorting, and eventually any kind of problem. And their focus, again, is gradual learning and reuse of knowledge. So how do you actually learn some knowledge, put it into memory, and then later on be able to reuse it for more complex tasks? Another team is looking more at biologically inspired methods. So STDP type of rules, which are the rules that are used in our brains that allow us to actually learn. So they are different from backpropagation and from other types of learning. And another team, they developed a system called toy architecture. Actually, here we can see their schematics of their system. They focus on spatial-temporal compression. And actually, if you're interested in more detailed talk about their stuff, they presented this a couple of months ago at Machine Learning Meetup in Prague. And we have a number of other teams, but they're still in development, and we'll talk about them in the future. So now, a little bit about our initiatives. As I said, we try to get there as fast as possible. So what is the thing that is actually slowing us down? We believe that there is a number of things. One of them is that many people are actually really too focused in what they do and not look outside. They're stuck in their local optima trying to increase performance by a few percent, but not actually solving the real problems that relate to building generally intelligent machines. And also, there is a lot of disparate areas, disparate algorithms, but no unified approaches of actually getting to general AI. And we try to mitigate it by being as open as possible. We published a framework, which is essentially a description of all the things that we're trying to do, even though this is actually ongoing and a lot of things have changed. And we also published this agent development roadmap, which you can see here, which is essentially a collection of the kind of learning tasks that we want to subject our agent to, so that we end up somewhere here with a generally intelligent agent. So this, we believe this helps for people to actually find out about what we're doing and encourage them to also try to do those things. And then we're taking a number of initiatives, the Institute and the Challenge. So with the Institute, what we actually found out when we try to figure out what's out there is that there are not many documents or descriptions of roadmaps on how to actually get there. There's one from MIT, there's one from Facebook, but that's more or less it. And how do we actually compare? How do we contrast them? How do we say which one is better and which one is more likely? Or how do we actually identify which aspects of the field of AI are actually under-researched, underrepresented, and maybe which ones are the ones that are fashionable, really interesting now, but maybe limiting in the long term? So how do we actually do this, and how do we keep up with all the research that's being published? So you know, there's so many papers on archive, so many things are happening, no human being can actually keep up with all of this. So how do we actually do something about all those things that can push us even further. And for this reason, we founded this institute, which tries to compare roadmaps, tries to identify the dead ends, the fashionable things that we shouldn't really spend too much time on, and generally mapping the whole landscape. And we're trying to organize a number of events, make it collaborative, getting people to actually get interested in this problem, start publishing their roadmaps, and compare them. And we had a number of meetings already, and we're planning more of them. So if any of you guys are interested in discussing those kind of questions, then please come talk to me afterwards. So this is one approach. But the other approach is, actually, we have identified a number of key concepts that we believe are really important. Gradual learning, learning to learn, or meta-learning, and a number of others. But how do we actually speed up the research in those areas? And for this reason, we decided that actually we can create a challenge. And for this reason, we started about a month ago this general AI challenge. So how many of you heard of this challenge before? Okay, some. So essentially, it's a series of rounds which have total $5 million pool money. And it started with the first round, which is all about gradual learning. So how do you actually create an agent that is able to learn gradually more and more complex tasks and can show that it's reusing the knowledge that it previously learned for solving faster and more complex tasks? And there's $50,000 in prizes. We have hundreds of registered teams or individuals from all over the world, and we organize a number of events. We organize another one in New York in the next few weeks, and we might still be organizing more. So if you want to find out more about this, then I suggest you have a look at those events. And this is just the first step. So we're going to actually, depending on how this goes, we're going to continue creating more and more rounds and trying to focus it more on the problems that are still unsolved. Safety, road mapping, and so on. And for those of you who don't know what it's all about, as I mentioned, it's about building an agent that is able to learn gradually. Yeah, so this is actually a current problem, because a lot of times when you train some agent, once you actually show it a new task, new problem, it forgets everything, or if it doesn't forget, it grows exponentially, and many other problems. And in the task, we actually worked with Facebook on defining a set of very simple tasks that are text-based. It's a communication between environment and the agent, and there's some reward, which is increasingly being actually disconnected and converted into textual reward. And the goal is this gradual learning, which should show in actually speeding up the solutions as you go along. So if you actually have an agent that solves the task without gradual learning, it will take it will require much more data than if you actually reuse the knowledge that you learned as you go. And the evaluation will be done on a completely different set of tasks, on a completely different curriculum. So actually, this is one thing that we haven't really talked about much before, and there are some things that make it really hard. Actually, the challenge looks simple because it's just, the environment is just made up of strings and some reward, but actually the data is very non-stationary. What this means is that each of the tasks, there's some drift in the concepts that are needed in order to solve the task. And usually when you actually deal with any kind of learning, or most algorithms, they assume some property on the data, some independence, IID property of the data that is stationary, but this is not the case here. And we also don't provide any kind of knowledge about when the task switches. So you don't know if the agent is actually performing badly because it learned badly, or because it's another problem that it needs to solve. Right, so those are actually really hard problems, and even on an environment and in a setting where it seems really, really simple, it's actually dealing with really hard challenges, which is made even worse because the amount of data that is being presented to the agent is quite limited, and there's no replay, so actually the agent needs to be able to maybe remember or store somewhere the data that it has seen in order to be able to evaluate the accuracy on the past data when it actually internally changed something. And if you want to validate, you have to actually create your own curriculum or play around with the existing one. So this was the first part that outlined more or less what we are doing at GoodAI. And now I would like to talk a little bit about more technical things that personally interest me. And they relate to a lot of this stuff. And as I mentioned before, that actually a lot of researchers, they do their research, they always find something better, some local optimum, and they're stuck in their field. But actually, if we really want to achieve general AI, maybe we're actually there, right? And we can never actually get there using the methods that we are currently using. So how do we get there? And for me personally, I find really interesting to look at other fields that have nothing to do, or indirectly have nothing to do with machine learning, AI. And actually our background kind of hints at this as well, right? So our company is a games development company, so a lot of the things that we do are somewhat different. The approaches, the focus on this road mapping, on planning ahead, it's quite unconventional for a research company. And I think for researchers, it's really interesting to look at different fields. Of course, neuroscience is the standard one that everybody in AI in some form or another looks at. But other things like complexity science, game theory, which is increasingly being used in deep learning and explaining how different neurons or different nodes within a deep network actually communicate with each other and how it can be explained using game theory, control theory, and physics. And I think in physics there's a lot of interesting work that is really underrepresented. And today I'll talk about two things. One method based on neuroscience, specifically neural correlates of consciousness, which sounds a little bit vague, but hopefully you'll see that it's actually quite formal. And physics, specifically computational mechanics. So how many of you actually heard about computational mechanics? Nobody, exactly. The scary thing is that actually in statistical physics, it's a field that is famous for suicides. So people are saying that it's supposed to be so complex, so advanced or whatnot, that all those people, they were thinking so hard that they ended up committing suicide. Hopefully this will not be the same story with us, but so what is actually computational mechanics? This is a field of physics that is interested in looking at any kind of systems that generate some data. And actually, when you think about it, more or less everything, every living system, many interactions in the natural world, they do this. And they look at the dynamics, the computation, the inherent computation that systems do, whether living or non-living, and they describe those things in terms of information theory. And there's one particular definition which I'll focus on, and that is actually the structure in a stochastic process via causal states. Right? So it's a study of the structure in a stochastic process via causal states. And this definition was originally defined by Jim Crutchfield from Santa Fe Institute about more than 20 years ago. And it has been more or less completely ignored by the AI and the machine learning community, with some exceptions, I think about two papers, one at ICML and one at NIPS. But actually this is all about predicting the future given some historical data, which is exactly what, you know, all of us are trying to do. And the main concept that actually came out of this field is something called epsilon machines. And I'll try to explain to you what this concept is and why it's interesting. So imagine that you have this kind of stream of data, and this is some kind of process that generates it. So you can think of this actually as the world, or, you know, the Earth generating sunny and rainy days. And what you're trying to do is you're trying to estimate what is the underlying process that actually generates this. And if you try to actually estimate it in your head, it's actually quite hard, right? What is the rule? But actually, when you look underneath it, it's just some finite state machine that actually generates the sunny day with probability of 90%, and then with 10% probability that it goes transitions to the rainy day, and the same way back. So now imagine that we change this scenario a little bit, that we have one state which is a sunny state and then the rainy state. In the rainy state, you're 90% of the times, and only 10% of the time you have a sunny day. So you can imagine you're in England, for example. It always rains. The only difference is that actually when it's sunny, it's always rainy the next day. Now imagine that you actually have this stream of data. This is the historical data where we are currently here and time actually goes back. Then we can look at all the future possible states. So we actually know the truth. We know what the system is. So we can actually look that if we are in a rainy day, there is some chance, you know, 10% chance that it's sunny, 90% chance it's rainy. And then actually if it's sunny, then it has to be rainy. Right? But here it's different. Now, the next day comes, and actually it ends up being sunny. So you know that actually the future looks like this, right? Because you can only end up in a rainy day. Now, another day comes, and of course it's rainy because it's the only option. And again, you can look at all the future possible states that, you know, can come ahead. Now, what's interesting here is when you actually look at those two states, those two futures, then you actually notice that they're the same. Whereas this one is actually different. Now, imagine that you have a space of all possible histories. And every single point in this space is a different history. What you can then do is you can actually partition this space according to the futures that are likely. So if you remember that actually we had here two different possibilities, right? So this is one and this is another one. So actually we can partition this space into two different regions according to the future. And because we're trying to predict the future, this is all that matters, right? So irrespective of what history you're in, as long as the future is the same, you can partition your history according to that. So based on this, you can then, you know, have some way of actually reconstructing the true underlying process, because you already know that you have two partitions in this case. Now, more generally, this is actually achieved by something called the equivalence relation. What this says is that actually one history is equivalent to another history if the probability distribution over its futures, given that one history, is the same as the probability of the futures given the other history, right? So irregardless of what history, if you end up in a state which ends up with the same future, you can put them together. You're not losing any information. And I think this is a really, you know, really neat formulation of what's really relevant for prediction or for building systems that actually care about the future. Right? So how many of you actually seen this kind of expression before? Some people, okay. Which field of?
Oh, I just saw similar.
Similar things. There's some things in language theory, but yeah, it's not sufficiently known. And if you actually have this equivalence relation, and then if you assume some other properties, then what you can do is, if you actually have all the histories, all the futures, then theoretically you can reconstruct the true underlying system that generates the data. If you don't have all the histories, all the futures, there are also some approximate methods that are able to actually take this space that is not complete and partition it, and then build some approximate things. So actually this epsilon machine, it's the generator or the process that generates the data, the epsilon machine, it's minimal and optimal predictor that is defined in terms of a set of causal states. So maybe this will be a little bit confusing because before I had different notation, but essentially now the S is the set of all the causal states, R are the partitions, and H now actually denotes entropy, because actually the epsilon machine is essentially the set of the causal states. Now the causal states are the states that are defined from the partitions, defined by this equivalence relation, because then you actually make sure that the states are causal, right? They are the most minimal elementary set of states that are necessary in order to reconstruct the data. And also it's made up of a transition matrix that is per symbol, so, or from the alphabet. So in the case that I showed you before, the alphabet is S and R. And actually you can think of it as a type of hidden Markov model, with the difference that the states have a specific structure, which is defined by this equivalence relation. Now, so we have actually the definition of how to define the optimal predictor. And what we can do with this, it's really interesting. We can actually, if we calculate the entropy over the probability of being in any of those causal states, then this defines something called statistical complexity. And this is one of the most useful measures of complex systems that physicists or complexity scientists have. And this measure actually defines how much information that needs to be stored in a process in order to be able to reconstruct the data. So, of course, if you have very simple repetitive pattern, then you don't need to have many states, you don't need to have much variation. But if you have a very complex sequence of things, then you need more and more states, you need more interactions, and therefore complexity goes up. And the amount of data needs to be stored goes up. And you can also think of it as actually the bits of information that a process stores while communicating from the past to the future. So you can imagine that the process is actually in the middle and the past actually communicates some information to the future, and the statistical complexity gives you this measure. Now, some of you might know about Kolmogorov complexity and other measures of complexity, but actually in some sense you can argue it might be wrong depending on what you're interested in. But Kolmogorov complexity, essentially, it looks at how random a process is. So with randomness, complexity increases, right? So if you imagine that Kolmogorov complexity measures the number of strings that are in the program that are necessary in order to reconstruct some string, then actually this is the way it operates. The more random the string is, the higher the complexity. But actually, randomness is statistically simple. If you think about it, a truly random process is kind of irrelevant, insignificant from the statistical point of view. And this statistical complexity measure actually captures this much better, because we don't want to actually care about systems that are truly random, right? We want to care about, you know, these kind of systems that are somewhere in between, that use stochasticity to actually give you some benefit in modeling or generating data, but not something completely random, because if it's random you don't really care about it because you can't predict it anyways. So this is one aspect, but the second aspect is that actually those epsilon machines are model agnostic, which means that they are not only specific to some finite state machines or hidden Markov models, but it's a universal framework for actually defining the ways to actually build those representation using any model class. Right, so you can imagine, or you can see here, that those are different machines or different representations, where here is just the raw data stream, here is some tree representation, finite automaton, string production machine, or some Turing machine. You can essentially, you can use any of those to represent the data. And what Crutchfield said is that what you do is you start at the lowest level, and then when the computational limits of that representations are reached, you jump to another step. So you innovate. And then actually what happens is that this representation is more efficient in some sense, and you can actually solve more complex tasks within it because you can then compute it. The troubling thing is that for each of those representations, you have to define this equivalence relation, because the equivalence relation that I showed you is only defined for those hidden Markov model type models. Now, why is this interesting for us, besides the fact that it's an optimal predictor, theoretically, and so on? Well, actually, for example, for the challenge or for solving any kind of set of problems that have different complexity, you can actually employ this to measure the complexity of the task and say something about, okay, is this task really harder than another one, right? So if you can actually represent the problem using some generator of data, then you can employ this to actually measure the complexity of the task. And this can actually tell you something about how much memory or how complex your agent needs to be in order to be able to actually represent this optimally or approximately, depending on how you define it. And this might in turn be able to tell you something about, you know, how to deal with memory. So if your agent cannot optimally reconstruct the data or represent it, then I need to forget something, right? So you deal with some form of forgetting. So maybe it can tell us something about how to actually how to limit the memory, how to use the memory or the limited amount of memory that we have in order to be able to appropriately use it for the right problems. And there are a lot of other things that you can use, you can employ this with. So you can think of actually developing different equivalence relations and actually encoding them into existing methods. So if you imagine some recurrent neural networks, then you can define, for example, some equivalence relation as an object function that will allow you to actually give some structure into the internal workings of the RNN that have much more meaning than being completely decoupled. And for me personally, there are some links to sample complexity, because most existing methods, they are too data hungry. We need so much data for those deep learning methods, but actually this is not really the way that we operate, and we don't believe this is the right way to actually achieve general intelligence. So we need systems that require much less data, and sample complexity is one way of actually measuring it. And I hope that those epsilon machines are able to tell us something about how to do this. Now, one example that we haven't solved yet, but might be interesting to look at, as I mentioned, one of our teams is looking at those memory augmented neural networks. So essentially there's some controller, some LSTM, RNN, whatever, and you have some read and write heads that have access to some external memory, and rather than actually storing all the information in the weights or in the activations, they store it in the external memory. And what they have shown is that actually if you have this external memory and you're able to write or hard code specific functions in the memory and then only learn the composition of those, then the learning is much more efficient in the hundreds of samples rather than millions. So this is really interesting. And actually, if you look at RNNs, so many people say even though they might be Turing complete under certain conditions, they are much more like finite state machines. And so what I'm saying is that actually the jump from LSTMs or RNNs, more or less RNNs, to memory augmented neural networks is similar to this innovation step in those epsilon machines. So here you can see that this is a finite state machine representation of some simple problem, whereas here on the right it's some representation of memory augmented neural network. So you have one bit of memory associated with the state. And linking this to learning theory, we might be able to say something about why actually it's much more efficient to learn in systems that have external memory compared to systems that don't have it. And but for that, of course, we have to define this equivalence relation, because we have this additional bit of memory which impacts our histories and our futures. So this is still an unsolved problem. And we might be able to use different measures or methods in statistical learning to actually link those two things. So I don't know how many of you know about statistical learning theory, VC theory, Rademacher complexity, but this one might be a little bit interesting for epsilon machines because it relates to essentially the correlation of a hypothesis set with random noise. So you measure how actually how much capacity, bless you, how much capacity or how powerful your hypothesis class is based on how well it correlates with random data. So this might be one of the ways to actually look at it. And even though the method of epsilon machine was developed 20 years ago, it's actually actively still researched, and actually a huge amount of work has been done recently. One interesting work is on epsilon transducers. So actually one of the limitations that I mentioned here is that it deals with stationary data, right? So if you want to actually deal with this, then you can use epsilon transducers, which is the same thing as epsilon machines, but rather than on individual system, you look at the communication between them, right? So you can model the communication between two different systems using an epsilon machine, and this is an epsilon transducer. So you can imagine that you have multiple different systems that represent your stationary process actually drifting, and then you're able to model this drift, this change, using another epsilon machine. And yeah, compared to a lot of other things, epsilon machines can deal with continuous state spaces. So, you know, there are no limitation in this sense. But as I mentioned, the original definition is only for stationary process, unifilarity, which is a special property of the state machine where the transition probability and the symbol uniquely defines the next state, and the fact that actually there is no concept of actions or rewards, even though there's some work that actually links actions and rewards into this framework as well. So how are we doing this time? 7:30, okay. So the second and last part is something that relates to neuroscience. This is another field of research that a lot of people focus on when developing AI, but not so much on consciousness. So there is this theory called integrated information theory, which was developed by Giulio Tononi, and it's actually interested in consciousness. So he's a neuroscientist. He wants to actually measure how conscious people are for medical reasons and some other ones, and he have actually shown that you can use some measure called phi that shows you when a person is unconscious, when a person is sleeping, so there is some kind of partial consciousness, and when they are fully awake. And this measure is interesting because it's a quite well formally defined theory that he actually says that is a necessary and sufficient condition, which means that it's sufficient to actually explain consciousness, which is the bit that many people complain about. But for me, that's actually not so relevant, because I think computationally there are some interesting properties in this theory. And in very layman terms, it's all about this holistic experience. So what kind of experience you have as a complete experience that is not possible to divide into parts. You can also think of it as that the whole is more than some of its parts. And this is a formal framework to actually define this. And it actually looks at the degree of causal influences in a system. And I'll show you what it is. But not between pairwise, but between multiple components in a system. So if you have a neural network or some kind of modular system, it looks at all the possible combinations of nodes or modules in the system and how they influence each other in order to process some information or do the task that they do. And yeah, they look at spatial temporal influences, so mainly over time. So now you can imagine that you have some very complex system. This is some representation of C. elegans' brain. And what we want to do is we actually, for simplicity, we only look at two components across time. So actually, this is one component, and this is another component. sorry. This is one component, this is another component, and this is in time. So we're current, this is present time, and this is history. And what this represents are all the influences between the components and across time. Right? So you can actually see all of them here, where we have some equal time influences. So this component actually influences, I mean, the two components influence each other at the same time, here and here. Then you have cross-time influences, which are essentially all those yellow lines, because they go across time. And then you have the individual cross-influences, which only look at the different components across time. And then you have self-influence. So this system influences only itself across time. Now, you can think of this system as the full model. So given some complex system, you can imagine that actually the model is somehow fully connected, potentially. You don't know, you don't care. And what we want to do, we want to be able to actually disconnect those models depending on those influences. So for example, if we only look at the influences at the same time, then there's actually no influence over time, across time. Yeah, so I'll show you how, but actually this corresponds to mutual information between the system across time. Yeah, how much mutual information there is when looking at the system at this time point versus this time point, but no influence between. This is the concept that we're interested in, which is this integrated information. So how much information is actually integrated, or how much synergy there is, how much influence there is across different components. And so what we do is we actually remove all those bits in the middle, because we want to actually see how much information or processing is possible in a, with a system that is completely decoupled, completely disconnected, compared to the fully integrated or fully connected system. And there are some other measures that you can derive. And this paper, which talks about a way of actually measuring it, it's called geometric integrated information, uses a method of information geometry that actually says that what you can do is you can measure the KL divergence, which is a measure of probability distributions and how similar they are. And by actually going over all the possible disconnected models, and you try to find the one that is most similar to the fully connected model. And how you can do it? You can actually define the constraints that define how you actually break those influences. So in the mutual information case, you actually make the two times independent, right? So you actually equate the joint probability distribution with the fact that actually they can be independent. With the integrated information, what you do is you define a constraint which actually says that your current point in time that might depend on all the previous components is equal to the probability distribution of this component only with respect to itself before. So what you're doing is you're disconnecting the influences in such a way that you only look at modules in the system. So you don't look at cross-module influences. And what actually happens is that in information geometry, you define everything in terms of manifolds. Manifolds are spaces that represent probability distributions that locally have some interesting structure properties. And this MF manifold is essentially the space, which is kind of not shown here, but it's everywhere, which is the manifold of all the possible probability distributions. So every single point is one possible full model there. And then there's another manifold, MD, which is the flat manifold of the systems that are constrained by our constraints. So in this case, this is the constraint which defines the space. In the integrated information case, this is the constraint. And information geometry gives you some interesting properties. And what they found is that actually when you want to minimize this difference between this system and then this disconnected system, what you're doing is you're actually finding the projection of this fully connected system, this PX, onto this manifold. And you can use Pythagorean theorem to actually find the solution. Right? So you actually, this is the disconnected system, and you try to find a point in here that is the closest to the full system, and then you have the solution. Now, why is this interesting, or what does it actually mean? Is that actually if you have a fully connected, or if you have a fully distributed system, a system that does not depend on the interactions of its modules, then this fully connected system will be actually lying on this manifold, right? So this phi measure will actually be zero, right? So it means that you tried all the possible disconnected systems, and you find that the disconnected system is the same as the fully connected system, which means that your system can be actually decomposed into different components, and it can do the same job. But if your closest disconnected system is far away, then phi is large, which means that there is information processing that is happening that is not possible to do with the parts independently. And there are some rough links to actually some recent advances in machine learning. In Giulio Tononi actually showed that feed-forward systems are not integrated, which means that actually they have phi of zero. But recurrent systems, they tend to have higher phi, so they tend to have much more interdependence. And there are systems called residual networks. How many of you heard of residual networks? Okay. So what Tommaso Poggio from MIT showed that actually residual networks, which are essentially a special type of network with some kind of skip connection which passes the unchanged data to the next layer, that you can actually represent it, if you share weights, as a recurrent neural network. So what he's saying is that residual networks are interesting because they try to approximate recurrent networks. And for me, this is interesting because maybe there's this link to this integrated information which makes it more powerful. So the fact that systems that are integrated have different, you know, maybe computational benefits over systems that are decoupled. So for me, the question is, how does this relate to sample complexity? If you imagine that you have a more integrated system, it means that you reuse more knowledge, you actually need less parameters, and of course, from the statistical learning point of view, you need less data, right? So this is potentially interesting. And in terms of this gradual reuse of knowledge or gradual learning, you can say something about actually how much information you can reuse or you should reuse in order to be more efficient or more effective. Now, the interesting thing is, if you remember before, I talked about memory augmented neural networks and the fact that external memory allows you to actually be more efficient. But maybe systems with external memory are more modular, right? So there seems to be a little bit of contradiction. But maybe this is actually a necessary trade-off, because what you're doing is you're essentially trading off the way that a system is integrated, so how much each of the parts depend on each other, and kind of systems are really hard to actually control and put prior information in. Whereas if you have external memory, you can easily put some code in there, you can put some functions in there, so you can actually put prior knowledge. And if you put more prior knowledge, you need less data. So maybe there's a trade-off between modularity in a system and the amount of information you can actually put there into it, prior information, and amount of integration that is more efficient, smaller, more compact, but harder to control. So I think there is actually many more things that link all those things together. And I like to look at those things individually in terms of the properties that we are looking at in GoodAI, gradual learning, meta learning, and some links also to statistical learning. There's this concept of robust generalization. How do you make sure that irrespective of what kind of data you actually see during training, you end up with always the same good result? And there's a lot of concepts that I believe can be translated from one to the other to allow us to actually build systems that are different, that are unique, and that are inspired by different fields, different points of view, and different representations. So thank you very much. That's all for me. And if there are any questions.
Thank you very much again. And now it's space for you guys and for questions. So just raise your hand and I will bring you the mic. So I have one question for you. You are trying to use general AI, and I would like to know how much are you inspired by neuroscience and medicine, and how much do you cooperate with the people from this field in GoodAI? Is there any cooperation or no?
Well, we have a number of people looking at this. As I mentioned, one of the teams looking at STDP-like rules. And in terms of collaboration, we don't have any official collaboration, but we are in touch with some groups that also look at this. So each of the teams, they freely communicate with the authors of the papers that actually they got inspired by. There's a company in Japan that is doing, for example, this consciousness stuff that I visited a few weeks ago. And we're trying to find ways on actually how to exploit each other's knowledge in order to actually get us further. So there is a lot of potential, and I think there would be benefit to actually get more collaborations. And actually last week I was in the US and I tried to get people from Santa Fe Institute, which is one of the most famous complexity science institute, to actually organize some events with us to get them more involved in AI and machine learning, and for us to get more involved in their work, because there's a lot of computational methods that look at many different areas and different problems, and they might actually have solved some things which we are still trying to solve, and communicating and figuring out how to actually combine them would be really good.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks for the talk. I was wondering, could you give us some examples of the tasks which are actually in the AI challenge? And do you have some human baselines for those tasks? Can people do it?
Okay, human baselines, we have them, we are working on them. I don't think we have released them yet, but we have a number of people who are actually doing it by hand. In terms of the examples, I might have some video of it, but I'm not sure if it's actually those are some examples of the environment. Actually, you can download this on the website, and you can see that actually you have the environment which is presenting some strings, and then the agent needs to output something according to this, and then there is a reward that is being presented. And this is a very simple example. I think this one is trying to reproduce, I think, the number before the dot. I'm not 100% sure, But essentially, all the tasks are very simple in terms of you have some set of symbols, and for example, at the beginning, you have to learn one-to-one mapping. So for example, you have to reproduce exactly the same sequence as the environment gives you. Or you have to do one-to-many mapping, or many-to-one, or many-to-many. Then you have to learn some delimiters. Then you need to start actually learning some simple words. And this essentially grows more and more complex. And eventually, it ends up using some more natural language type of communication with the environment. So does that? I think there's another example that is more, based on language that makes sense to us. But actually, we don't want people to really use any kind of NLP methods to solve this, because there's no guarantee that during evaluation there will be any English or any other language used. For this reason, there's this mode which essentially hides or converts or maps it to a completely random language that is kept fixed, but that is not understandable by humans.
Okay, some other questions?
Hello, can you explain the slide, the third slide from the end about the success of ResNet? Can you explain like more detail about the like relation between the ResNet and the link theory that you explained before?
Mm-hmm.
Thanks.
The link is very simple.
Yeah.
So
yeah, I mean this slide. Yeah.
So the argument is that Tommaso Poggio showed that ResNets can be actually, or ResNets are approximating recurrent neural networks. And as results have shown, ResNets have become one of the most successful representation in deep learning. And what I'm saying is that there is somewhat a possible correlation between the fact that ResNets are trying to approximate recurrent neural networks. Recurrent neural networks actually have a higher level of integration, and this means that they might be actually more efficiently reusing the knowledge that they learn, and therefore they might be able to be more powerful in learning to solve the problems that they're solving. Does that answer your question? Thanks.
Okay, some other questions?
Could you please very briefly mention the inspiration from statistical physics? Because at least what I know, statistical physics usually assumes some distribution already known. So this is probably not the goal to take some distribution and say this behaves like this. So could you briefly mention where you can get more inspiration in statistical physics?
Mm-hmm. Well, the methods that I talked about right now, they don't actually assume anything. Okay, well, I think computational mechanics is subfield of that, but other than that, in terms of statistical physics, I don't have particular example answer for you, so I cannot tell you right now which method I would advise, but I think there are number of areas in thermodynamics and methods developed from this that I think Max Tegmark was talking about that actually link deep learning with some forms of, I can't remember the name now, but ways that actually people are measuring systems using statistical physics. So there's at least two or three papers that actually show that there is relations between some standard machine learning methods like logistic regression and some other representations in deep learning that clearly link to statistical physics. I can provide you with the references. And I think what's interesting that even though each of those methods might have some limitations, there might be some other aspects that they developed for solving their problems that could help us.
Yeah. Okay, some other questions?
Hi, thank you for your presentation. I would like to ask, on the beginning you have mentioned two brain simulators. Mm-hmm. I guess they are based on the way how brains working. So what are the most complex problems I am able to solve in the simulators?
Well, those simulators, even though they have a brain in the name, they're actually not necessarily inspired by the brain. So this environment is much more standard machine learning. So you have machine learning methods that you can plug and play, put them together, and actually you can do as you know similar things that you can do with other standard machine learning methods. But there is not that much neuroscience methods. Whereas this one is much more inspired. I wouldn't say by neuroscience, but by the way that we can actually build architectures that dynamically grow. All of this is fixed, and here actually we can do some learning or some training, and we can actually adjust the topology or adjust the architecture of the system as it learns. Yeah, this is still, I mean, it's still in very early version, but it was focused on essentially having this much more dynamic systems that can adjust and that can distribute its computation across many, you know, many cores or many systems.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, other questions?
Well, it's not a technical question, but it's a question that I bet you get a lot. In GoodAI, you want to get to general artificial intelligence as soon as possible. Mm-hmm. But how do you ensure that you get to general AI as safe as possible? How do you ensure it's good AI?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Yeah, actually, a lot of people they notice the name good and they first ask if it's really related to safety. Of course, we also think about this issue, and one of the initiatives that we're undertaking right now is we're looking at potentially having a next round of the challenge on safety, on how to actually guarantee or how to push the boundaries on safety research. And we're collaborating with some of the top people in the field to actually write a proposal and to help us define the challenge in such a way that that would actually help us. Other than that, right now we're trying to solve things like gradual learning, learning to learn, and still those problems are so hard and still so far that we believe that there are, you know, other ways to do it, like this challenge that actually will help us or keep in check actually the safety aspect.
And then OpenAI?
Sorry?
OpenAI?
Well, not specifically. We communicate with them. I think we have some communication with them also regarding the safety challenge, and we try to essentially communicate with everybody that does those things, and it's more or less up to them. And but a lot of the groups are actually quite open in talking with us about a lot of those things, so it's quite actually surprisingly positive that the groups talk to each other and collaborate.
Question about road mapping, how to compare road maps and what methodology to use for approaching the road mapping?
Mm-hmm. Well, that's a really good question. I think it's a really hard question. We have some internal measures of actually how to compare it in terms of some kind of task that we want to achieve. So we actually published a number of blog post. The first one was about this internal comparison. And actually, it's really hard to define some metric or measure based on which we can meaningfully compare things is quite difficult. One of the things that we haven't really developed at all, but for example, if you think about those Epsilon machines that I talked about, there might be a way to actually, if you think about milestones that you have in a roadmap, they define actually where you are in time, and irrespective of how you get there, as long as you achieve the milestone, then you actually reach that goal. So there might be some ways, and we're actually discussing this, and we'll be discussing it on some workshops, on how to actually more formally define a set of guidelines on how to actually write roadmaps. Because right now, each of the roadmap is so different, so disparate, they look at different ways, they define differently how they actually want to achieve it. Some provide some goals, some provide some much more abstract things. So right now it's all about actually reading those things and trying to find ways on how to compare them. One way to do it also is we have defined in our Asian development roadmap a set of prerequisite intrinsic properties that we believe are necessary for general AI, and we try to see if those systems, they satisfy those things. But even that, it's quite hard because a lot of them overlap, and finding a common subset that we can say, okay, does this have, I don't know, unsupervised learning, does it do some kind of action reward system, does it do generative, you know, generation or things like that, it's quite tricky. So we hope to actually come up with some set of guidelines fairly soon. Thanks.
Okay. Hello, I would like to ask you for a personal opinion on how far are you from creating the real AI? Do you think you will be able to make it within the 10-year countdown?
Okay, of course, that's why I'm, you know, working on it. But I think we are still far in some sense, but I think focusing on the right questions will actually make this leap. And we believe that, you know, this, for example, this gradual learning or learning to learn are two fundamental things that actually, if we get right, we are then able to scale it up in such a way that it will actually end up generalizing to unseen tasks. And this really doesn't exist. So I think by focusing on this, by distributing the problem not just to ourselves but to the community, and actually incentivizing it by money and by other things, then we might be actually able to get much quicker to some level of machines that are able not only very well solve one thing but multiple things. And once we're there, I think that's when we can ask the question, you know, how far are we? Because if we actually reach the situation where we have a machine or agent that solves a set of, you know, fairly unrelated tasks, then we're really on a good way. But yeah, within 10 years, we'll have to have it.
Hi, would you mind introducing briefly the GoodAI roadmap, please?
Well, the GoodAI roadmap, as I mentioned before, essentially has, there is a number of things. So the framework essentially defines a lot of the things that I talked about, like the intrinsic properties, the way that we want to speed up the search, what actually intelligence is, and it's a document that defines all those things that we believe are important. That doesn't mean they're correct, but at least at the point in time when we published it, this was one way we were looking at the problem, and of course since then it evolved. And at the same time, this roadmap is this document here, which has some architecture-specific set of properties that the architecture has. You know, it has to be able to do all types of learning, supervised, unsupervised, semi-supervised, and so on. It needs to be able to generalize, it needs to be able to deal with actions, and so on. We have a number of those properties there. And then once we have an architecture that is satisfying sufficiently many of them, and now we believe that this gradual and learning to learn are actually some of the fundamental ones besides the standard, you know, generalization and so on, then we can actually send it through this curriculum that is, again, it's not complete, but it, for example, deals with some textual, visual tasks that eventually will end up with a sufficient representation that we'll be able to use in a more complex world. Where in this part, it's actually a world which is discontinuous. It's just some, you know, separate environments, and then it becomes more and more concrete, more and more based on some structure. So we end up with some toy world setting where you have some kind of a top-down view of an agent that is moving in its environment, that is grounded in some physical setting, and then as you move down, you end up in some 3D environment, such as space engineers or medieval engineers, then you end up going to more natural world, YouTube videos, the real world, and so on. So those are the kind of two things that define the roadmap and the way we approach it.
Okay, we have a few minutes, so some questions.
Thanks. Hi. Isn't it better to specialize than to go through the general AI approach? Like, for example, you have a person who speaks native English, but when he learns the second language, he's not as good as the native speaker in the other language. So isn't it kind of like the specialization leads to better result than the generic approach?
So you're asking if it's whether it's better to specialize rather than being general?
Right.
Yes, if you're, what you're trying to do is trying to solve some specific problems well now. But eventually us, we actually, yes, we might be very good specialist in some advanced areas right now, and it's more difficult to divert, but we're still actually much more general in the kind of things that we can solve. And computers or agents that we have right now, they cannot actually generalize to anything. They generalize to some unseen data from the same problem, from the same distribution. If you actually drift it or change it, yes, you can do some transfer learning and you can do some tricks, but it's still very limited in the domain, and once you actually show it something sufficiently different, it fails terribly. And we humans are actually much better at adapting, and we need to develop systems that are able to do this, and then once we have that, then we can actually have systems that maybe specialize on this, maybe specialize on that. You know, it's not that we will have a system that will be perfect everything, because in some ways it's impossible, but we're interested in focusing on human level AI. So any problems that humans are good at, and we believe and hope that eventually if we have those kind of systems that any of the problems from the subset that we care about, you know, the systems will help us with.
Okay, thank you.
Thanks.
I have a question about GoodAI as a company, mm-hmm. which is that how do you make sure you survive those 10 years? Because the artificial general intelligence is obviously a big goal, and well, you need funds to survive. So I'm wondering whether you're functioning more as a research group and relying on investment, or if you have a viable business model. And also if you're planning to extend your team and potentially employ more people in the future. Mm-hmm.
So right now it's funded by Marek, and he planned it in such a way that we have funds enough for 10 years. Of course, that doesn't mean that if there are some, you know, low-hanging fruits that we can exploit, then we'll do that. So for example, this is where GoodAI Applied comes in, because we have some set of tools or methods that we developed, and we can actually apply them right now to business. And of course, if we can monetize it, then why not? And in terms of looking for more people, I think we're always interested in talking with people who are interested in actually solving and dealing with those things. And you know, if you're interested, you can always contact us, come and talk to us, and yeah, we can see from there.
Are there any last questions?
Elon Musk.
Yeah. So the question was how many companies that do the same things as us. I think there is a number of them, but each of them with slightly different focus. I think, for example, OpenAI, even though they try to solve AI, they don't focus so much on the long term. They still focus quite heavily on existing methods and how to push them forward. They have some interesting leaps in their research that is exciting, but I wouldn't say they're standard in the sense that they would actually say, okay, we want to achieve human level AI or general AI and we have some longer term plan. Maybe they do, but we're not aware of it yet. Of course, DeepMind, that's their plan as well. They're much more focused towards general AI, but again, they don't have publicly anywhere, you know, their roadmap. There is Maluba, which was acquired by Microsoft, who was also kind of focusing on this, but again, showing actually their progress through some standard methods, and that's why they got acquired. And there are some other teams. There was one Araya from Japan that I visited a few weeks ago, that looks at it from the point of view of consciousness and building conscious machines for different purposes. But again, it's very much related to AI or general AI. And there might be some other companies, but it's not sufficiently many because not many companies have the privilege of actually being able to do such somewhat crazy research without having, you know, direct applications that will be needed for them to run. So a lot of the companies, they actually have to focus also on developing algorithms that bring them money in.
Is there any last question? Or okay, there is the last.
Do you have plans on applying some of what you're doing in games development, such as general agents capable of adapting to specific game environments?
Game environments. There were some plans. We actually incorporated space engineers into Brain Simulator. And right now, it's not our primary focus, but we're not ruling it out. I think, of course, the environment of the games is potentially a huge asset for having an environment in which to learn, and we might be looking into that at some point in the future.
So thank you very much, Honza, do you have a talk?